Good afternoon. Welcome to This Week in Turkey. Joining us from Washington, D.C. today is U.S.-based economist Hande Akmehmet, and she'll answer our questions on yesterday's central bank decision and its possible short-term effects on the Turkish economy. Good afternoon, Ms. Akmehmet. Welcome once again to This Week in Turkey.
Good afternoon.
So as you know, the central bank increased its benchmark interest rate by 625 points yesterday in an attempt to boost the underperforming Turkish lira and also perhaps to ease investor concerns. First of all, how do you evaluate this rate hike?
Yes. So in central bank terms, we definitely call this a strike. Central Bank of Turkey increased interest rates by 625 basis points yesterday, like you mentioned. This was a necessary and useful monetary tightening step. And the bank delivered a very strong message to restore confidence. But it is also so unfortunate that it was such a latecomer. The main policy rate now stands at 24%. But with this increase, the good news is that Turkey's 10-year bond yield immediately risked to 19% levels, which shows that increasing the short-term policy rate helped the country to lower its long-term borrowing rates. I have three major points on this move. One is that I think the goal of the central bank was definitely to surprise the markets by exceeding the majority of the expectations and delivering an increase much more than predicted, and they have done so. Secondly, this move is just more than a simple interest rate hike. Now, Turkey's monetary policy is much simpler or more conventional, or orthodox, as economists call it, and this will send a very positive message to the markets. If Turkey moves to more conventional monetary policy, much simpler to understand. So the central bank, what they have done is that they have returned to conducting their full funding capacity from the one-week weekly repo options rate instead of the overnight lending rate, which means that all of the CBRT's funding will now be done from one policy rate, which is 24%. Now we need to calculate weighted averages, which was a major, which was a more complex method for the global markets. Even though, for example, the previous policy rate was 17.75, the real effective fund cost stood at 19.25. Therefore, what this decision really leads to is a 475 basis points of effective tightening. Before the decision, Turkish lira was around 6.4 against the US dollar, then plunged to 6.1, current floating around 6.14, 6.15 level. The third major point is that I think this action was definitely about fighting inflationary pressures. The inflation in Turkey stands at 18% according to the official August numbers, which is at its highest since September 2003, the year that Erdogan first took power as prime minister. But it is not just about what this stands at. With the recent fluctuations in the Turkish lira and the Turkish lira losing almost 40% of value against the US dollar this year, Turkey entered to a vulnerable economic state with 70% of its debt denominated in dollars and euros, current account deficit at 6% of GDP, and almost 20% inflation rate. Without a corresponding monetary act, which could have balanced the situation much earlier, all of these factors started to cause major imbalances in the Turkish economy's pricing dynamic, which is extremely crucial. Uncertainty, fluctuations, currency depreciation, and the worsening sentiment in producers and consumers are some of the factors that pressurize this imbalance even furthermore. One other point is that the producer price in Turkey jumped the producer's price index jumped to 30% in August. Therefore, we see a widening gap between the producer's price index and the consumer's price index, which is another sign of imbalance. The inflationary pressures on the producers are more severe than the consumers. Therefore, yesterday's action can be counted as the first of actions that need to be taken in order to fight inflation in Turkey. The initial reaction we observed from the global long end of the yield curve is positive, as I mentioned earlier. However, the yield curve in Turkey is still inverted, which is a technical indicator that suggests that something can be structurally wrong.
So this rate hike that we've been talking about so far came despite President Erdogan's earlier remarks against a possible increase in the interest rates by the central bank. And Finance Minister Berat Albayrak has said, following the central bank's decision, that the debates centered around central bank independence in Turkey are now over. Would you agree? Where are we, in your opinion, right now in terms of central bank independence in Turkey?
If they want it over, I believe that they just need to take this issue out of the political debate realm. Since 2014, the interest rate inflation relationship has become a chicken and an egg situation, and this was dragged for a very long time as a political debate. And I strongly believe that this should immediately be seized from this book. This is an economic state issue that should be supported by articles, economic models, monetary policy examples, and solid evidence. It should not be used as a political bait because it damages the structure of the economy now. Back then, during the 1980s, for example, we had the phase inflation monster in Turkey, if you remember. Literally, inflation was traded in currencies and customs and news cycles, and this inflation monster became a public phrase. Everything bad and evil in the pricing dynamics was tied to this monster as if it had kind of life. Jokes aside, this represented the chronic inflation that Turkey has battled for more than 30-35 years before the inflation rates came down under 10% levels. I think it's the story now with a different take. Interest rates are shown as a source of all evil. So it is a very similar situation. Economic theory suggests that all with reasonable interest rate, you can cure, tackle inflation. Just like what we mentioned in the beginning, increasing the policy rate is actually helping the country to lower its long-term borrowing rates, which is a great sign. Therefore, I think the major part of the problem for Turkey was that no one was owning up to the problem. And global markets just don't trust any inflation monsters or anything that is surreal. Therefore, going back to the Turkish Central Bank, the decision yesterday was definitely the first step in owning up this problem. It was a good first step to show that Turkey's Central Bank can exercise independence when push comes to shove.
And Ms. Akmehmet, what are your expectations about the soon-to-be-released medium-term program? In fact, it's expected to be released very soon, in a matter of days. How do you think it can help cure the recession, or what looks like a recession at the moment?
This year's medium-term program is much more crucial than ever before. We know that it will be announced on September 20th, which is next Thursday. Government needs to present realistically calculated programs and measures with solid timelines in order to combat this current state of recession, or recessive economic condition that's currently in. And in order to restore the confidence of the international investors that the upcoming policies are on the right track. It was Mehmet Şimşek's job to announce it before. In last year's OBP, the midterm plan, they had the growth forecast for 2017, 2018, and 2019 set at 5.5%. The rate of current account deficit to GDP projected to be at 4.3% of GDP. Now it's around 6%. Unemployment rate was forecasted to be at 10.5% levels. It's around 10 in the official calculations, but the youth unemployment in Turkey is still very problematic. And most importantly, inflation was forecasted to be 9.5%. Now it's at 18% levels. Therefore, global markets are going to monitor this plan, are going to monitor if this plan includes realistic numbers and forecasts. And that's the only way it will inject any confidence and trust in the new economy management team in Turkey. If there were to be rating charts showing how realistic these plans are from a 1 to 10 scale, this has to be 9 or 10 in order to convince the global markets that strong team that is ready to do whatever necessary is there.
And finally, what do you think about yesterday's decree? As you know, a decree was issued by President Erdogan yesterday, which will require using only the lira for buying, selling, and renting real estate and vehicles. Can this have a curing effect on the Turkish lira, in your opinion?
I think the intentions were good, but I found it too general and a little bit problematic, honestly. I looked it up, and under the Turkish Code of Obligations, for example, according to Code 99, it states that parties can agree to hold contracts and payments in other currencies besides the national currency, which is the lira. Code 304 states that real estate renters market can actually decide independently about the currency that they would like to use. So, I mean, where does this, most recent decree fit in? I mean, it's very hard to tell. Even if it wasn't problematic legally, I still found a little bit too general. I think it needs to be condensed. It needs to be studied by each sector and even subsector. And in some sectors, they find that it will do more harm than good. Therefore, I believe that they need to special exemptions for each sector in order for this decree to be effective. If they don't, it's just going to be on the surface and it's going to affect the real markets predicted.
Ms. Akmehmet, thank you very much for joining us today and for your comments.
Thank you for having me.
Today we were joined by US-based Turkish economist Merihan Akmehmet, who commented on yesterday's central bank decision to increase interest rates and the possible short-term effects this may have on the Turkish economy. And now we'll continue with our next news video. The Central Bank of Turkey increased its benchmark interest rate on Thursday to 24%, a hike of 625 basis points from the previous rate of 17.75%.
The lira touched as high as 6.003 against the dollar immediately following the announcement. The rate hike came alongside a pledge by the bank to enact strong monetary tightening in order to support the price stability amid recent economic turbulence. If needed, further monetary tightening will be delivered, the bank said in a statement. This was the right decision, commented Timothy Ash, senior emerging market strategist at Blue Bay Asset Management. In a series of tweets, Ash wrote, "The Turks just gave themselves a chance to hold the lira and rebuild the trust of the market. They can get out of this without the IMF and without resort to capital controls. The rebalancing will be brutal. But with the right policies herein, there is now a way out," Ash added.
A decree issued by President Recep Tayyip Erdogan will ban foreign currency contracts for sales, rent and leasing.
In a new step to support the local currency, President Recep Tayyip Erdogan issued a decree on Thursday announcing that contracts for sales, rent and leasing must in the future be made in Turkish lira. The move came as Turkey's central bank increased interest rates sharply in an attempt to curb the tumbling lira. The currency has lost almost a third of its value against the dollar since January. Thursday's decree, which was published in the official gazette, said all current agreements in the property sector made in foreign currencies must be changed within 30 days. Rental and sale agreements in Turkey are often offered in euros and dollars to foreigners living in the country. In a speech to a Traders' Confederation in the capital Ankara, Mr. Erdogan said on Thursday that nobody should carry out business in foreign currency apart from exporters and importers. He also criticized Turkey's central bank, accusing it of failing to control inflation and urging it to cut interest rates just hours ahead of its announcement that it was raising rates to 24%. As of today, I have not seen the central bank fix inflation rates as they promised, Erdogan said. Interest rates are the cause, inflation is the result. If you say inflation is cause, the rate is the result, you do not know this business, friend, he added. The Turkish lira jumped sharply following the news of the rate increase.
Foreign Minister Mevlüt Çavuşoğlu has said in a press conference that Turkey is aiming to stop attacks in Idlib and is ready to work together with all partners to eliminate the terrorist groups in the region.
Diplomatic attempts are being made to prevent the Russian-backed Syrian operation in the province of Idlib, yet the tension on the battlefield is escalating. Late Sunday night, Russian military forces announced that the US forces had carried out an airstrike on Syrian military targets in civilian areas. According to reports in the media throughout the week, Russian forces also carried out airstrikes in the Idlib region. Earlier this week, US Ambassador to the United Nations Nikki Haley sent a warning to Russia, Iran, and the Syrian government claiming that there will be dire consequences if they continue to launch airstrikes within the Idlib province. Meanwhile, Turkey also continued to deploy troops and heavy weaponry to its southwestern border with Syria, in anticipation of a major offensive by the Syrian government and its allies on opposition-held territory. Turkey also boosted diplomatic efforts regarding the issue. On September 11th, Turkish Foreign Minister Mevlüt Çavuşoğlu held a press conference in Romania, stating that if the Syrian government and Russian attacks on the province of Idlib stopped, Turkey was ready to work together with all partners to eliminate the terrorist groups in the region. Hours later, Turkish presidential spokesperson Ibrahim Kalin warned the European Union that a potential influx of refugees from Idlib would also reach the European continent. At a moment when we have already been hosting millions of refugees, a new influx of tens of hundreds of thousands of people towards Turkey would lead to different complications. Its effects will not only be observed in Turkey, but will spread to Europe and other countries, Kalin said. According to Hurriyet Daily, officials from Turkey, Russia, France and Germany will meet in Istanbul over Syria in a bid to seek political settlement in the country. The issue will remain on Turkey's agenda throughout next week. Mevlüt Çavuşoğlu told reporters that Turkey is still working towards a peaceful solution for Idlib, adding that President Recep Tayyip Erdogan would hold talks with Russian President Vladimir Putin on Monday.
President Erdogan has appointed himself as the new chairman of the Sovereign Wealth Fund.
Recep Tayyip Erdogan has appointed himself as the chairman of Turkey's Sovereign Wealth Fund and relieved the management staff. On Wednesday, Erdogan announced that Berat Albayrak, his son-in-law and the Treasury and Finance Minister, would act as his deputy, while Zafer Sönmez, head of Turkey and Africa for Malaysia's government investment firm, was named general manager. The overhaul comes 2 years after the government formed the fund to capitalize on $200 billion of state assets, including stakes in flag carriers and fixed-line operator Türk Telekom. But the organization's goals and strategy were never clearly defined, and in 2017, an internal strife led to the firing of its first chief executive officer, after Erdogan publicly expressed his disappointment.
Cumhuriyet Foundation elected its new board members last week.
Cumhuriyet Foundation, which owns and runs the Cumhuriyet Daily, has held a repeat election to elect a new board after the previous election was cancelled by court last week. The previous board, whose term was mostly marked by court cases and the imprisonment of newspapers' journalists, was replaced by new members led by Alev Coşkun. Meanwhile, Aykut Küçükkaya became the new editor-in-chief of Cumhuriyet instead of Murat Savuncu. Meanwhile, Aykut Küçükkaya became the new editor-in-chief of Cumhuriyet instead of Murat Savuncu, who spent 17 months of his 24-month-long chief editor position in prison. Speaking to Oda TV, Coşkun said that the transition was a peaceful and lawful process. Critics of Coşkun, however, have shown discontent towards his chairmanship due to his links with the Nationalist Fatherland Party and Daily Aydınlık, a newspaper associated with the party. Several columnists and journalists announced their resignation from the newspaper following the board change, citing a suspected shift in values and principles of the new board members. Renowned columnists Aydın Engin, Çiğdem Toker, Hakan Kara, Aslı Aydın Taşbaş, Ahmet Tulgar, Melis Alpan, Bağış Erten and reader representative Güray Öz announced their resignations on September 9th. Mirgün Cebas, Barbaros Şansal, Mahir Ünsal Eriş and Binnaz Saktanber also announced that they would no longer contribute to the newspaper's supplements.
Turkey beat Sweden 3-2 on Monday and lost to Russia on Friday in the UEFA Nations League.
Russia beat Turkey 2-1 on Friday in their first UEFA Nations League game. Turkey was defeated at home in the League B Group 2 match. The first half ended 1-1 with a goal scored by Russia's Denis Cheryshev and one by Turkey's Serdar Aziz as he equalized close to halftime. But Ardam Tuzba restored Russia's lead 4 minutes after the break, and the match ended 1-2. Turkey clawed back from a two-goal deficit to defeat Sweden 3-2 on Monday in its second match in the Nations League at Sweden's Friends Arena. The first half ended 1-0 with a goal by Sweden's Isaac Kiesetelin. Sweden made it 2 in the second half with Viktor Claesson. But shortly after, Hakan Çalhanoğlu came through for Turkey with a shot that got past goalkeeper Robin Olsen. Emre Akbaba built on the momentum with 2 goals, sealing a 3-2 win for Turkey, which saw Sweden defeated at home in their first Nations League match.
Batuhan Aydagül from the Education Reform Initiative gave an interview to Medyascope this week on Turkey's education system.
Well, the Turkish education system suffers mainly from a lack of quality education in schools. Over the last 20 years, enrollment rates have been increasing, school attendance have been increasing, and we have now more children in schools than actually ever. So while enrollment has improved, learning outcomes have not actually. And what Turkey really needs to focus on is to improve its learning outcomes. If we take PISA as a reference point, the latest results after 2015 showed us that Turkish students declined. Turkish students' performance declined over the last 3 years in math, science, and reading altogether. That is quite actually bad for the country, because what the country needs is really to improve the cognitive skills, cognitive outcome of those students. We also know that unless you improve the quality of schooling, there is actually a limit to which you can improve expand access, because while kids start school, the schools actually, if the schools don't have enough pulling capacity, if they don't act as magnets, then actually we observe that, and we know that those students drop out of school, especially boys, and do something more meaningful to them than school. So if you look ahead, in order to improve the learning outcomes, we will have to first and foremost focus on teachers. It is well accepted across the spectrum that Turkey has neglected education, has neglected teachers in the last 15, 20 years. They feel, teachers feel disempowered, they feel lonely. So we really have to boost their morale. We have to make them feel important again. And to do that, we have to actually empower those teachers. They need the agency back, the agency to actually to do something meaningful for the school, for those students, because our system is very centralized and hierarchical, and as such, it doesn't leave any space for the teacher. So that's a huge room for improvement, but other areas will be needed. School finance is critical. We have to improve school finance and maybe transition to per capita financing. We have to fix secondary school. The academically competitive schools are doing good, but the rest, and the rest is approximately 90%, still suffer from low quality of education. We have to invest in leadership, school leadership. You know, principals are key. Obviously, the whole system needs to be more meritocratic. That has been quite criticized lately, that the government has not been promoting its teachers, its principals, its administrators, its actually officials based on meritocracy, but rather on loyalty. And obviously, we have seen the difficulties which came with it. So, but right now, I mean, in the beginning of this new academic year, there is an optimist atmosphere reigning over the education system due to the appointment of Professor Ziya Selçuk as minister. He is a well-known figure in the Turkish education community. He's well respected by actually a lot of actors, right or left, conservative or secular. Obviously, he is facing a lot of challenges, definitely including the lack of trust of the opposition towards this government. That would be difficult for any minister, including Ziya Selçuk, to overcome. He has to actually, he has to prove very quickly that he is meaning business to the community. There are a lot of low-hanging fruits that can be gathered by effective policy making and implementation, which would both actually address the concerns of some actually in the opposition, whichever opposition that might be, but also he would gain credit, political credit, which he would need later on to use in order to undertake some more radical reforms, which could actually be objected by some of the stakeholders, which that would be critical.
That's all from This Week in Turkey. Thanks for tuning in and hope to see you again next Friday at 5 p.m. Goodbye.